everybody. Welcome to One Drink, a podcast where we talk about one topic for one drink. I'm Matthew.
And I'm Oliver.
And I'm Captain Tammy Poynton Grimes from the Colonial Belle.
There we go. And thank you for coming on. We appreciate it.
It's our first captain. We never had a captain on before.
Never.
It's cool.
So,
I wish I had a captain's hat.
Yeah. I wish I could. So how is it that you become a captain?
So for the canal, you have to have a U.S. Coast Guard license. So you have to have 360 days on boats in general. And then 180 of those days has to be on the boat of the tonnage of the license that you're going for.
Okay.
So I have what's considered a 100-ton master's license from the U.S. Coast Guard. And it makes me a officer of the Merchant Marines of the Coast Guard.
I mean, that...
I don't know what that means, but it sounds awesome. Cool.
Yes, yeah, it does.
Sounds really cool. It sounds like it was a lot of work to get it.
Yep.
Because 360 days, I mean, that's a year.
Yeah.
You have to have 180 days, which is 6 months, on at least
boat.
A big
that's
boat.
What you're going for. Yep. So. And then you have to go through the Coast Guard testing, and it's 4 pretty complicated tests. For me, some of it, we don't use the information on a regular basis. So even though my family's been in business since 1989, and we've had this vessel since 1995, there are things like charting and all those types of things that we don't use on a regular basis on the canal, but because the canal ultimately hooks to the ocean, it's a similar license.
Mm. Nice. So it's not anybody can just be like, oh, I'm going to get a captain's license.
If you want to get an intro license and you have boating experience and you have a small boat, the first level is to get something called a six-pack license where you can get up to 6 paid passengers on your vessel.
It
could be a pontoon boat or a fishing boat. There's tons and tons of people in the country with those licenses.
Got it.
The higher up licenses, there are licenses far larger than mine, which will indicate the size of the vessel that you're able to operate.
Yeah.
So you're good up to 100 tons. That's a big boat.
Yeah, and the Belle is technically, so the Coast Guard tonnage versus actual weight are not the same thing.
Oh, okay.
So our boat is actually considered 37 tons. However, actual weight, it weighs over 110 tons, and that's a lightship measurement, meaning that if you put on fuel, water, furniture, any of those kind of things, you add another 10 to 15% for that weight.
Gotcha.
So she's heavy.
Got it.
All right. How big is the boat itself? Tell us about the boat.
So the Belle is 60 feet long,
okay,
27 feet wide. Told you how much she weighs.
Yeah.
It has a single engine and prop. So a lot of larger vessels have two. So they call it twin screws. We have a single. And a lot of large vessels have bow or stern thrusters that help you push the boat around. We do not have that. The vessel was built in 1961. That technology wasn't around as much back then. So the canal averages about 100 feet wide in most areas. So a 60-foot long boat, when you turn it around in a 100-foot wide canal with a single engine and no bow or stern thrusters, it's a little tricky until you get used to it.
Yeah. So you're doing it old school,
Yep.
It's like driving a car with no power steering.
Oh,
kind of, yeah.
In a very small space.
With passengers on
with
board.
With passengers on board, right.
Yep.
That's sweet.
That's pretty cool, though.
I always wanted to
drive like a big boat. And I've always had boats, like as a kid growing up, my family had boats, you know, but I mean, I'm talking just little
boats. And that's where we started. We had multiple generations of family with small pleasure boats. My dad owned a medical supply company for, I think, 26 or so years, and his company got bought out by a larger company. And so when that happened, he decided he wanted to do something with his hobbies. So my dad was a commercial pilot. He owned a seaplane, and he also was a lifetime boater. So he decided he was going to do one of the two, but he realized that boating was something that he could bring the family into more. We leased a boat for one season in 1989. It was kind of our market test. We did it one season. It worked really, really well. So then he bought a boat. We were in Pittsford. We moved to Fairport eventually. We ended up having a business split between my dad and his business partner. My dad bought a bigger boat, and we're still going.
Nice.
That's awesome. That's awesome. I love that it's a family thing, too.
Yes.
I mean, I know that working with family gets...
Well, in our business, it can be wild sometimes. Our business, I helped from the time they started it. I was super young. And then as I got older, in 1995, I was 18, and I started working as a full-time deckhand. At that point, they needed to have a first mate or senior deckhand. So you had to have at least 30 hours on the wheel. You had to be able to turn it around and dock it, emergency things in case something were to happen to the captain.
Yeah.
So I had to get those hours in quickly, did that. And then I was with the boat until about 2008, and I, in 2000, opened my own business. I own 2 dance and music schools. And eventually I had over 800 students, two locations, et cetera, et cetera. I was super busy. So I wasn't doing a lot with the boat business except for behind the scenes. But in 2016, my dad passed away. He had a heart attack.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And I realized that for this business to continue the way that we had done it, I probably needed to go back. And it's a great business. I do love it. And so I finished my season for my students. They had their June recital, and then I went back to the boat business.
Yeah.
And that's when I revisited the getting the captain's license, because I never went after it before, even though my dad wanted me to do that from the time I was 18. Mm-hmm. And so I did that.
Wow.
That's awesome. Yeah. That's, and I feel like you're the busiest person that we've ever had on the show.
I was like, I don't feel so bad anymore being as busy as I am, but...
I feel like I don't do shit.
Yeah.
You know?
So,
And you have four kids?
We have four children collectively. We're a blended family. So my youngest is going to be four May 1st. So I had a baby right on top of boat season a few years ago. So that was exciting.
Super cool.
And then the next one up is 8. My bonus son is 11. And then my daughter is 17.
Holy moly.
So
I'm not nearly that busy, and I only have one kid.
Yeah.
And you don't have any kids.
I have a cat. I have a cat that meows all the time.
You're right.
But I have seen the Colonial Belle going down the canal.
Mm-hmm.
And I have never been on it yet.
Me neither.
So this summer.
It's time.
It is time that I take a trip on it. I've heard it was great. Now, when you're on the ship, what goes on when you're on there? I mean, is there food? Is there... drinks? Is there?
It depends on the cruise. So the first thing we do in the beginning of the season is we offer field trips for students.
Oh, okay.
So fourth graders study New York State history in the Erie Canal, and many of them go for a cruise, thousands of students from the area. So we do that. We do a narrated cruise, question and answer, that kind of thing. Then we also offer cruises that are narrated lock tours, where we go from Fairport to Lock 32 in Pittsburgh, go up and down in Lock 32. It's about a 25-foot lift.
Oh, okay.
And then go back to Fairport. And I narrate the cruises as I'm driving the boat. We have other ones where there's lunch available, there's dinner available, and then we have, this season, I think it's about 59 different themed cruises.
Oh, okay.
Where there's different bands on board, we have murder mystery, we have a comedy cruise.
Ooh, a murder
pirate
mystery.
Pirate cruises, all kinds of stuff. And they're really fun, and people love them. And that those are selling already very fast.
Yeah.
And then we do private charters, where people can rent the entire boat, and they have all kinds of different things.
That's cool. We have
weddings, we have corporate events, we have parties for weddings and or for birthday parties, anniversaries, that kind of thing. Almost anything you can think of, we've had a charter for it at some point.
It seems like you have everything covered.
Yeah, that's like, super cool. I like the murder mystery just caught my attention. I'm a huge like true crime guy. So the murder mysteries, I've always wanted to do one, just a regular one, but doing one on a boat, I mean, that sounds even cooler to me,
fun.
So I'm going to have to look that one up. So if you see me on that ship, I'm going to be like, Captain Amy! Do you remember me? She's going to be like, get this guy off the boat. I don't know who you are. Like, no, I was on that podcast you were on that one time, remember?
Yeah, I like the whole private party thing where you can just rent the whole boat
for
yourself. That's
super cool.
You don't have to...
Oh, man. I feel like I don't have enough friends for a boat that big.
I know. I feel bad. I was like, I would love to rent that.
Rent the boat and I get six people on.
Oliver, well, Tammy's going to be there. My girlfriend. Can I bring my cat?
Right.
Four people. What the
heck? Four people and a cat.
Yeah.
Sweet. Because you know Ross won't go on the boat.
No. So that's great. So you've been all over Rochester, all over New York pretty much, promoting. Is this like an every year thing for you, like this time of season? Do you go to all these spots, promote?
Mostly, yes. So the canal obviously has a season to it. We start in mid-May and we go till the end of October.
Yeah.
This year, the PGA is coming to town.
Mm-hmm.
So the canal officially opens to the public on May 19th.
Okay.
But I have a few other hats. So I'm the president of the New York State Tour Boat Association, and I'm also the chair of Canal New York Marketing and Business Alliance. So when I put on all those hats, I talked to the Canal Corporation, and I said, look, we have the PGA coming. There's going to be thousands of people in the area for the golf tournament, oh, but they want to do other things in the area. Mm-hmm. So could we cruise a little bit sooner? The other thing we were running into is those children's field trips that I was telling you about. They're so popular that we were running out of spots for them before school ends and when the canal opens. So this gave us more time for that. And then also Mother's Day falls in the middle of that. So we're offering a Mother's Day brunch.
Perfect.
So I asked them if we would be able to do this, which included the not the whole canal, because some parts of the canal are very different. There's natural waterways that were incorporated into the canal, mm-hmm. and opening those sections sometimes is a little different than opening our section. But I was able to get it so that Lockport, Pittsford, and Fairport, which is us, were able to start our cruises about a week earlier. So we start on May 12th instead of May 19th.
Nice.
So that's really exciting.
Cool, yeah.
And it's really cool that they were, you know, willing to do that.
Yeah, we've had some growing pains. The New York State Power Authority took over the canal about 6 years ago. Prior to that, the canal was under the management of the New York State Thruway. And so whenever there's a change, there's some growing pains, if you will, as
always.
Things get worked out. And we're in a good place now. It was a little rocky to start with, but it's much better. Obviously, they need to do maintenance. The canal in our section is 200 years old. Mm. The entire canal will be 200 years old in 2025.
Mm-hmm. What?
So all of these locks and bridges and structures and all of this stuff need maintenance and work, and they're old.
Yeah.
So they use the time when they're not in the navigation season with boats going through to work on some of these projects. So they pump out locks and they replace parts and they replace doors and sometimes they redo the whole lock. And all of that happens in the off season. So they need as much time as they can, but it's a balance between operating businesses and boats and all of that stuff with their maintenance.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's crazy how it just, everything works to, you know, how it works.
Super cool.
So with the PGA coming, it's very, very big. Do you have any like, now do you think, I mean, you're going to get business from it no matter what, because what you guys do is pretty much a staple in Rochester. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows about it. You know?
Pretty much. There, we still run into people once in a while and they're like, Colonial Belle, what's that? But for the most part, people know what it is.
Yeah.
Which is cool. But we've been around for a long time now.
Yeah. And it's, I can't wait for my first time.
I know. Me too. I'm pretty excited.
I've been around, I feel, forever too. And I've seen it 100 times, but I've never been on it.
Same. Same. Well, it's one of those things too, where you don't really think of it too much unless, if you've been here for so long and you've seen it for so long.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because, I mean, I've lived in Rochester, you know, my whole life. And I never lived in Fairport, but, you know, I mean, everybody's been to Fairport, and everybody's seen, because, you know, you can see the boat when you're in Fairport, and, you know, I've always looked at it and been like, oh, yeah, that's the canal tour. I've never really thought about doing one before, but, I don't know, now knowing that there's, you know, events and themed cruises and private charters and more than just, you know, like a, you know, I don't, no offense to it, but, you know, you think of that when you live in the city and you think, oh, it's like a touristy thing. You know what I mean? But that's like, you know, if you live in New York City, you know, nobody goes up to the Empire State Building when they live in New York City because they're like, oh, whatever, it's a tourist trap. You know what I mean? But it's so much, you know, doing the reading on your website and then, you know, now talking to you before the show and on the show, I'm like, oh, it's so much more than just a touristy attraction, for lack of a better word. You know what I mean? Like it's an event. It's a day. There's food. There's, you know what I mean? There's all kinds of things that go into it. So it's not just sitting on a boat for 2 hours.
Right. Oh, and the other thing I didn't mention is we have a full bar on board too. Oh, so
you're on the right show to talk about a bar being on the freaking boat.
Yep. So we have mixed drinks. We don't carry any well liquor. So all of it is top shelf. It's a small bar, but we have pretty much anything you can imagine. We have beer, wine.
Well, if you
frozen ever, drinks are awesome.
If you ever need a guest bartender for a day, I worked in the restaurant business for almost 20 years. So
cool.
As a bartender and general manager for a long, long time. So
cool.
If you ever need an extra hand on the boat,
all right,
bartending. I don't know much about boats, but
yeah,
I can make drinks. So.
There you go.
So speaking of needing a bartender, or whatever. So what's the staff? How many people are, like...
So it depends on the crews. So we have a pretty good amount of crew, which we call them. They're deckhands or crew. And then we have a few people that are just plain server bartenders where they don't handle the lines. Ropes are called lines on boats. Our crew has to be mandated by the Coast Guard. They have to be in a drug testing program and random drug testing program. They have to go through a bunch of safety trainings and things like that. But then we have some extra hands because sometimes the cruises are huge. We are certified by the Coast Guard to carry up to 149 passengers.
Wow. Does that include the crew?
No.
Oh, so it's so 149 just passengers.
And then beyond that, there's captain and crew. So some of those big cruises, when we're really busy, if there's a lot of food to serve or if there's mm-hmm. a lot of bar stuff or whatever, and then we've got to operate the boat. You got to be able to tie it up and get it off the dock. And when we go through the lock, you have to tie up in the lock and all of that. So we've got to have people to handle mm-hmm. all these things. So depending on the amount of people that are on board as passengers, along with what else we're doing on that particular cruise, will depend on how many staff we have on
gotcha.
Board.
Gotcha. Now, that sounds like a lot, but you also have to add on to that the fact that you can potentially do 2 or 3 cruises per day.
We do. Yep.
So not only do you have to get everything ready for one mm-hmm. and then get back and dock, mm-hmm. then you have to flip the entire boat to get it ready in, what, an hour
yeah,
for the next one.
Yep, it's quick.
So that's a
and we've
that's
done
like a
things where we've
dash
gone for like
of just
yep, we've boom, gone boom, with boom. Like a public lock tour in the afternoon, and then we come back and we've got to put a full band on board. We've got to set up rows for aisles on the upper deck for a wedding, and then there's a reception on the lower deck, and we've got to do oh and we do it in an hour. Oh, and people yes. are like, we Waltz. Need all this time to set up. Like, you don't, and we've got this, and yeah. this is how it works. And there's a plan, and you just mm-hmm. everybody has their role. And we get it done.
That's crazy. So it's you a guys crazy are, amount of organization.
You guys are good at what you do.
Yeah, but that's we've had a lot of practice.
Right.
Yeah. So that helps.
Yeah, 30 plus years of practice.
I can't say in 1989 it was quite as smooth with transitions as it is now.
Everything went wrong.
Yeah.
yeah. Oh, no.
But there's always something. It's, you know, if you work in a restaurant or if you work in a hotel or if you work in a mm-hmm. tourist attraction, there's going to be things that happen.
Yeah, yeah.
And the biggest thing is just, and, you know, during the pandemic, we were still operating. But it was 100% different in the way that we yeah, ever operated. Yeah. And it was, you know, they use the word pivot. We were going in every other direction. You know, 1 minute we needed to do this. And mid-cruise, they would change regulations, and we had to adapt.
Yep. And you're like, uh-oh.
I relate to that because I was in the restaurant business during the pandemic. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it felt like every other day it was, well, now you have to do this, or now you can't do that, or now you have to do this, or now you can't do that. And it's like, all right, let's just... Come on, yeah. let's figure out how to make it work. Let's start, get the measuring tape out. You know what I mean? Let's
yep.
let's figure this out. Because, you know, I'm not going down, yeah. you know?
Yep. Yeah, we were at half capacity, 6 feet, people 6 feet apart. Thankfully, the boat is wide, so that right. gave us space for that. The upper deck is completely open. There used to be a covering over the upper deck in the pilot house, but we had to cut it off for this boat to fit under the low bridges on the canal.
Got it. Mm.
So we were one of the few places that could have live music because we could put our band on the upper deck. So first, the bands were perfect. 6 feet.
Loophole. I love loopholes.
Yeah.
So the bands were 6 feet apart, and then they had to be 12 feet away from the passengers. And I was like, the night before that happened, I was like, how on earth am I going to create 6 more feet for these bands?
Yeah.
And I woke up in the middle of the night, and I woke my husband up, and I said, I need you to come to the boat with me early. And he's like, okay. So we had extra chairs on board. We could only operate at half capacity. So there's an area where the extra chairs were stacked. I said, we're going to put them in storage. We can't use them anyway. And then there were life jacket boxes in the back area mm-hmm. where we put the bands. And I said, if we take that out, I think it's 6 feet. And I was 100% right. So nice. We moved the life jacket boxes to where the chairs damn. Used to be. And then we had more room for the bands.
Nice.
So we made it happen.
Yeah. Perfect. Got to do what you got to do.
Yep.
And your husband sounds like a great behind-the-scenes guy.
He is
we were talking about him before the show.
Yep.
So,
yep, yeah. There's a lot of people in various organizations that I'm in, and they realize my husband and kind of, he's in a silent role most mm-hmm. of the time, but I call him my other 8 arms because it is a lot to balance a business like this and then also the children and our yeah. house and all our other responsibilities. So yeah. I definitely couldn't do it without that.
Well, and you were telling us, too, that, you know, he's met you off on top of bridges when you go over and drop stuff down that mm-hmm. That you need unexpectedly on
yep.
the cruise.
Yeah, passengers
broken toilet seats and all kinds
yeah,
of stuff, man.
Passengers love it, but
oh, I would too. If there was somebody dropping like a necessity off of a bridge or something like that, yeah. I would be so excited about that.
It is fun, and that's one of the beauties of operating on the canal versus a lake or an ocean, where other boats operate sometimes, is that we are close to shore and we are close to bridges mm-hmm. constantly. So mm-hmm. if we need something, we're not far away, and someone can get it to us.
Right.
So what is the one situation that sticks out that you needed something right away, kind of?
Well, the craziest thing that yeah. I think I ever experienced, my father was the captain at the time. We were in Lock 32 in Pittsford, and we were in the lower part of the lock, ready to lock up. Mm-hmm. And at that point, we were getting our catering at the lock. So my sister was working as a crew member, and we had dropped her off to go handle the ropes or lines on the upper part of the lock and also meet the caterer. Mm-hmm. So she's up there, and the lock gate came off of the thing. So we were down in the bottom of the lock, and it's 25 feet, and they needed to repair this, and it's not a quick thing. So my sister, the food at that time came in coolers, so I threw up ropes, and I had her lower the food down to the boat.
Oh, my gosh.
We served dinner.
Oh, right, because you're stuck at the bottom of the lock. Oh, my gosh.
My dad called the Pittsford Fire Department, because we were in Pittsford, and they had to quickly figure out how to put their ladders down instead of up, because usually they go up in fires. So they did that, and we served dinner, and then everyone climbed out the ladder to get to the top of the lock, and my dad got a bus, and we went back to Fairport. They fixed the lock overnight, and we went and got the boat in the morning.
My cool friend's dad was the Pittsford fire chief at one point, so I bet you he would have remembered that for sure. You know, Pat and Colleen, Colleen's dad.
Yeah,
he passed a couple years ago, but I bet you he was at least up to date. On when that was happening.
And of all the thousands of times we've been through Lock 32, that's happened one time.
Yeah.
So it's real rare that something like that would happen, but it did.
I mean, it happens, though.
There's always something.
Yeah.
We can, you know, we've had wild things happen. I was just telling you before the podcast here that one time we had someone break the toilet seat off in the middle of a cruise. And so I called my husband and I said, please go to Home Depot and get a toilet seat. Meet us at the lock. And my crew installed it on the way back.
That's
so
awesome.
We have more than one restroom, but still it's an inconvenience.
Right.
We were able to fix it kind of quickly.
Yeah. That's awesome. That's awesome.
Yeah. And when you do see that, you know, when you see that happening, you're just like, man, I love this ship even more. You know what I mean?
It's Oh, when you can see somebody just working that hard to just make everything work, you know, and even though there's other bathrooms, you know what I mean? But, you know, that, all right, let's get on this and get this fixed.
Yeah.
That's, you know, I always appreciate that extra effort, you know, because you didn't have to, you know, have somebody go get a toilet seat. You could just be like, sorry, this bathroom's out of order. But, you know, that's kind of the cheap way out.
Not
you know
the Colonial Belle.
And, like, knowing, yeah, exactly, like, knowing that, like, they got that fixed in the time that it took us to get from here to the lock and then out of the lock. It's like, oh, sweet. That's awesome.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Fixed.
Super cool.
And so when when you're on these tours for the crew or for you, they got to go by pretty quick because it seems like there's a lot in motion.
There
you
is.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So like this
2 hours just feels like it's real quick.
You're like, oh, okay. We're done.
Right. Yep. Yeah. And we're back.
It is very fast.
Not to mention you're sitting there narrating like a whole thing. At the same time.
Right. So when we have music and some of these other entertainment things, there's not very much narration, which is cool because some people love the history and the narration and pointing out the things along the way. Other people like to sit back and relax and listen to music and kind of chill out and cruise. So we have both options. So for the narrated ones, I'm talking a lot, but we don't talk constantly cause that's annoying.
Yeah.
So it's like in snippets.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But then for the other cruises, you know, I'm driving the boat down the canal and I always have to announce low bridge cause you literally have to duck down.
Oh.
We have a red railing that goes around the upper deck and you have to get down by that red railing cause the bridges are super low. Some are lower than others.
That's crazy.
Cause and I know the one in Fairport goes up, right?
Yep. That's a lift bridge.
Yeah, yeah.
So that one goes straight up.
Is that the only one?
It's the only one like it in the world, that particular bridge.
Really?
Most bridges break in half, and they open that way. The lift bridge goes straight up, and the things that are unusual about it, it's built on a hill, it's tilted from side to side, and each corner is at a different elevation.
Huh.
And it uses, there's no modern hydraulics. It's cables and winches and counters and pulleys and that whole thing that lifts it. So it's the old school way.
Wow, I didn't know that at all. That's super cool.
And they just rebuilt it. On a 22-month project, and redid the whole bridge, and they did it exactly the way it was. So they took it out piece by piece, and they used those pieces as templates and created new ones just like it. And
they do the same thing. So they kept it old school.
Yes, and they do the same thing when they redo the locks. You can't go to Home Depot or someplace like that and buy parts to an 1800s lock.
Right.
So they have these workstations along the canal where they take those things and they use them as a template and create new ones.
That's awesome. I love that they keep it authentic, you know.
Yeah.
Or, you know, as close to period as, you know, without ripping it out.
And the history of the canal is immense. Yeah. And the more of that that we're able to save. So now they're talking about the third century because we're moving into the third century of the canal.
Yeah.
And how we can preserve it for the next 100 years to keep it going.
Super cool.
And it will be there for 100 more years. I mean, it is so cool.
Well, with people like her heading the you know,
yeah,
the keep it up nice because we like it.
Yeah. So, but yeah, so the history of that canal, like we did a little bit.
It was like a feature in one of our shows or something like
that. But some of the stuff, you know, that went on to get that made was just
incredible.
Yeah. Incredible. Yeah.
So, and you couldn't even do that now, probably. I don't think you could find people that would hand dig a canal.
No way.
No way.
And I do believe there is...
Not for a cost-effective...
Mm-mm. Yeah.
It wouldn't be a cost-effective project.
And there is still, like, one bar, isn't there, that originally was there?
Oh, there's a lot of things. That
there is?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
We go past some of them on our tours.
Nice.
Richardson's Canal House, that's in Pittsford, that was an inn on the canal.
I just had Jackie's 40th birthday dinner was at Richardson's.
Yep.
Yeah?
Yep. Yep, that's very historic.
That's cool. I didn't know it was that. I didn't know it had been there for that long. For
and there's a lot of other buildings that have been redone into other things, but they're still there.
Still there.
That's awesome. So speaking of those little Erie Canal facts, I have a little list of facts.
Because,
you know, we like little interesting facts.
Gotta have
the show.
Gotta have
However, what I didn't think about as I was looking these facts up is that I was going to have an Erie Canal expert sitting next to me. I thought I was talking to a canal boat captain, and I'm talking to the...
Yeah.
She's the president of all kinds of things that are related to the canal, so... I hope that this website was good, because...
I don't know everything.
We're about to find out. Well, this is some basic stuff. Okay, so, started construction in 1817 in Rome. Cool. Grand opening was in 1825, which you just touched on a little bit because we're, you know, coming up on the bicentennial.
Yes.
For that. Length, it goes from Albany to Buffalo, the original.
Yep.
Was 363 miles.
Yep.
Now, can you go to Buffalo?
We could.
How far can you go?
So you go to kind of Lockport, and then you'd have to get into the Niagara River to go all the way to Buffalo.
Oh, okay.
So there's a lot of waterways that hook to the canal, and that's the reason our vessel, for instance, we bought in San Francisco, California.
Oh.
And they drove it home. The boat had been on the East Coast for a lot of its life, and then it was purchased by a company in San Francisco. They put it on a freighter, took it out there. It did business on San Francisco Bay, and when my dad found it, he was going to do the same thing, and it was astronomical to bring it home on a freighter. So I looked at my parents when they were talking about this, and I said, well, why don't you drive it home? My mom was like, no. And my dad's like, huh, maybe we could. So they did. They drove it down the Pacific Ocean, through the Panama Canal, up the Atlantic Ocean, down the Hudson River, and into the canal for 7 weeks.
No way!
Yes.
7 weeks?
Yes.
Holy!
That's great.
That's awesome! And that was cheaper than
shipping
sending it
by a lot.
No way!
Wow.
Yeah, it was, I have to look up the number, but just to get it to New Orleans was astronomical, and we still would have to get it the rest of the way to Fairport.
Holy that's awesome, though. Wow. That's awesome.
I know.
Just say, you know what? I'm going to go get this boat, and I'm going to drive it down through the fucking Panama Canal to get it here. That's awesome.
That's sweet.
I love that. That's my favorite part of this whole interview so far. I freaking love that. Okay, so the original dimensions, it was 4 feet deep, 40 feet wide, and the locks were 90 feet long. Then it was in the enlarged dimensions from 1862 when it got enlarged, 7 feet deep, 70 feet wide, locks were 110 feet long. And then the Erie Barge Canal, which I'm not sure what that is.
It's kind of what we have now. They merged the Barge Canal with what we now know as the Erie Canal.
Okay, and that was in 1918. And that's 12 to 23 feet deep, 120 to 200 feet wide, and the locks are 310 feet long.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, good so far. I like it. Number of locks in 1825 was 83. Today there's 57?
Yeah. So it's kind of a loaded question because there's the New York State Canal system.
Okay.
And then there's the Erie Canal. So when we're talking about the system, there's the Champlain Canal, the Oswego Canal, right. the Cayuga-Seneca Canal. Technically, Seneca and Cayuga Lake are connected. They call Watkins Glen the Key West of the canal because it's the most southern point.
Okay.
So even though it's a finger lake, it's still attached to the canal system. So all of that together is what we consider the New York State Canal System.
Okay. All right.
There's a lot that goes with the Erie Canal.
Yes. Yep. I was just in Oswego for a conference and also a meeting, and the Oswego Canal, for instance, I know less about because it's not the area where I am. We went to visit three locks yesterday.
Yeah.
One lock is a very similar to lock to, you know, what we have. Another lock that we visited is under construction. They do those pump outs every year. Mm-hmm. And it's usually about every 10 years or so they do refurbish on a lock, and they do several in the same year. So another one was under construction. They're just finishing that up. That was lock 8. And then lock 7, they did a multi-million dollar revamp of that lock. And that's the only one that I'm aware of that has hydraulics and things like that, where they changed some of the old school way. So we went to see that because I had a friend with me that's on my board for Canal New York. And I wanted to show her that. And the lock house is really cool. And the lock master chief was there. So he gave us a little tour.
That's cool.
And so pretty much when you're dealing with the multi-million dollar renovation, you're just redoing the whole thing, right?
Yeah, so that, they redid all the cement. They redid the lock doors. They changed it to hydraulics. They built a new...
Yeah, while there's water on each side, too.
Yes.
Right? You know what I mean? Like, people don't think about that. I mean, I know they drain it.
They do.
Still, there's still water on each side.
Something
they drain it to a point. So some locks, when they do the maintenance in the winter, they keep the water in because it keeps pressure on the dams, and it helps. Other ones, they lower it down. So lock 32 in Pittsford, they are on a two-year project of a pump out. So we got to go down in the lock last year and this year while it's pumped out. Last year we got to go down into the tunnels. They're about the size of a Volkswagen, and that's where all the valves are, where the lock empties and fills and all that. Yeah, we got to walk through that tunnel and see
it up
close.
That's cool.
And see the doors up close and walk around on what's normally the bottom of the canal.
That
was very cool. And then we did it again this year because they're redoing the gates. The gates have had a little bit of a leak in them for a long time, which wasn't a big deal, but the leak is getting bigger, so they figured they needed to redo the coin molding, which is wood that is right on the edge of the lock gates where they connect.
Mm-hmm.
So they're redoing that and, you know, fixing that part up. So we got to go down and see that again, too.
That's cool. And it's cool, too, because I've been to Lock 32 a million times because it's right here. And, you know, I've, you know, riding my bike when I was a kid, you know, with my dad going up and down the canal, you know, we'd always hit 32 and then go back.
Yep.
So it's cool to think that, like, you know, you were down, like, in there. Because I stood over it and looked at it, you know, a million times before.
Right.
And I've been through that lock on our boat a couple of times, too, which is
a trippy event
in a small boat.
It is.
It's one thing when the boat kind of, like, fills the lock out.
Fits.
You don't feel like you're so... You don't feel like you're getting lowered down into, like, a death chamber or something like that. But you're on a 22-foot little boat.
You're like,
open bow boat. And, like, you just start to go, you're like, holy moly.
People go through it in kayaks.
That's, right. No.
With the Belle in there.
Nope. Oh, my God.
Really?
With another giant boat in there? No way.
Man.
That's crazy.
Now, is that something you do have to look out for? Like, when you're going down the canal, there's kayakers.
There are lots of kayakers.
And, you know... Is there like a horn or...
I have a horn.
They see you coming, obviously. But.
They hopefully see us coming. One of the things that's difficult is if you are in an open waterway, the rules of navigation state that the boat with the least maneuverability has the right of way. So if you're a kayaker, a canoe, or a sailboat, and you're out in a big body of water, you have the right of way.
Got it.
When you're in the canal, which is considered a channel, the boat with the least maneuverability has the right of way, which would be the Colonial Belle,
because
we can't just move over to the side because it's too shallow.
Right.
So we have to pretty much stay in the middle of the canal as much as possible. So not every kayak or rowing scull or small boat understands that.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of, and there are specific signals that you're supposed to use with the horn, but most people
which
on the canal
don't
know that. So it's a little beep beep, and they're like, whoa.
Right.
And the other thing with the Belle is I can't stop it on a dime. There's so much weight and momentum that one time I tested it this last season, I put the boat in neutral when I was back at the Route 31F bridge, Fairport Road, and I was able to coast almost to the lift bridge without even putting it in gear.
Wow.
So that thing's not stopping.
So I can throw it in reverse and give it throttle and reduce the forward motion, but it's not immediate.
Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy.
Jeez.
Talk about another added stress.
It's another layer.
That's on top of the broken toilet seats and the you know, the locks breaking while you're 25 feet down in them.
And we got to get people down for these low bridges constantly.
Right.
So my crew, they're always upstairs to help with that. I announce the low bridge, or whatever captain announces the low bridge, every single time. Mm-hmm. And then people literally have to sit down. They have to keep their hands down because there's sharp edges and things that could hurt someone pretty badly. And then they watch the stairs so that nobody can ever not, you know, if they're downstairs not paying attention, and they'll walk up the stairs and hit a bridge, that would be terrible.
Yeah.
So the stairs are always watched, too.
That's crazy. So one of my favorite things to do on this show is when we talk about something old, is to find out how much it was then versus how much it relates to now. We love the comparison between money then and money now, because it really puts into perspective the, you know, the size and scope of a project. So the cost to build the canal in 1817 was a little over $7 million. And that in today money is $160 million.
It's crazy.
It's a crazy amount of money.
And that lock I was just telling you about, it was $28 million to redo that lock,
just to do that lock.
$28 million?
Golly.
One lock.
Oh, my
gosh. And how many are there in totality?
So, in the Erie Canal alone, there's 36.
36. That's a lot.
That's why they're not all brand new.
Yeah.
And now, is the Erie Canal funded by New York State? Like, you know.
Yes. So, the money comes from the state and from the power authority, which is an authority.
Yeah.
And then it goes to the Canal Corporation. The thing that's really tricky about the canal is that the canal brings in billions and billions of dollars of revenue to the state every single year.
Wow.
The halo effect, if you will, to, we'll use the Colonial Belle as just an example.
Yeah.
I have, we'll say 100 people. We can carry 149, but say I have 100 people on the boat, and then those people get off the boat and they go to the shops and the restaurants and all the things in the area, or they go to the wine bar that's near us or whatever.
Yeah.
That is more money being spread around because people came to the canal. And for the Erie Canal, people literally come from all over the world. So we have passengers from little tiny babies to people that are over 100 years old, and there are local people. There are people that are from out of state, and then there are people literally from all over the world that love canals, and they want to be on the Erie Canal.
It's so cool.
That's awesome. Yeah.
And that's so just cool. Our boat. You know, every single thing along the canal creates revenue for that business and community that is huge.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And that's part of the reason why a lot of the communities are even there. If you think of Fairport, Lockport, Brockport, they have port in the name, and the reason for it is because they came to be because of the canal going through.
Yeah. And that goes back to the earliest parts of civilization, too, where, you know, it's, civilization survived around water, you know? And then, I mean, that's why this area prospered so much, is because they built the canal to bring water to the area, both for transportation and irrigation and everything.
Yep. So it's a fun fact about Oak Hill. There's been a agreement since 1936, or a permit, where they draw water from the Erie Canal to water the lawns at Oak Hill.
Come on.
So that's our canal connection to the PGA.
Oh,
nice. That's cool.
That's sweet.
That's cool. Yeah.
Hopefully I get tickets this
year.
That's
a way cooler connection to the PGA than ours.
He faked being a golfer.
He talked me into it. And he faked being my manager.
And people fell for it. I did.
All night. So our very first show, we ever did, was that story, the story of that night when the PGA was here.
They were buying us drink, food, everything. Yeah.
That's funny.
Yep. Until they started
all
looking
night long.
Him up.
Yeah, until they started looking me up.
They're like, who are you?
I was like, Matt, we got to get out of here. And there's three people on their phones looking at us right now. We're not on the roster. Chug your last free beer and let's get the fuck out of here. And we did it at the Pittsburgh Pub, too. So,
right in
the golfer's bar.
Yeah.
Right. We went into the Lion's Den.
You did.
But so you said that there's a lot of people that go on your boat, which is amazing. Anybody famous step onto the Colonial Belle? Or somewhat famous, or anyone local?
Last year was the bicentennial of our section of the canal.
Mm-hmm.
So we did a couple of different events. Fairport did one on the day the canal opened, and then Parrington did one in September. So we did a flotilla, which is a boat parade, and the Belle led the parade. And it was in the evening, which a lot of flotillas are during the day.
Yeah.
And so we lit up the boat. So I had lights all over the boat, and I had special Coast Guard approval to have lights in the bow that are not usually allowed.
Mm-hmm.
And we had 200s lit up on the sides of the bow. And anyway, we had not necessarily famous, but we had town supervisor, the mayor of Fairport, the boards, people from the director of the Canal Corporation, various different assembly people, senators, that kind of stuff. They were all on the Belle because it was awesome. Kind of like being in a parade.
Yeah.
And people were on the shoreline up and down the whole way waving to us like we were a normal parade, but it was a flotilla.
That's
so
cool.
That was really fun. And we had other boats involved. We had a tugboat right behind us. They had some other police and fire boats on.
Yeah. It was great. How did everybody get back? Did everybody have to turn around?
We did.
And then the caboose leads on the way back?
Nope.
Basically?
So I actually was the one that coordinated all this because I had the most confidence.
Because this sounds like a logistical nightmare to me because I'm thinking about 30 boats on a small canal.
Yeah.
So we went from the village of Fairport under the Fairport lift bridge. They raised the bridge and left it up for all of the boats to go under.
Okay.
Which normally it's only a few boats and then they put it down and you have to wait and whatever, unless you're commercial. We can have it lift whenever we need it. So we went down to what's called the Oxbow, which used to be a small lake, and they canalized it. So we went down to the Oxbow, and I went over to the port side, and all of the rest of the boats would pass me, and then we all turned at the same time because they wanted the Belle to lead both directions.
Okay.
So I spun her around, and then everyone followed me back to Fairport.
Oh, that's pretty cool. What a coordinated move.
That worked out.
That
would
have been cool to see that whole thing transpire. That's pretty cool. Because I just figured everybody spun around, and then, you know, then the caboose led the way back.
Time to go.
That was thought A, but then they really wanted the Belle in the lead of the parade in both directions. So I was like, okay, how can I do this? And then I figured it out.
Nice.
And they had a big celebration party thing in Parrington Park, which we went past. So there were a lot of people in Parrington Park, but then there were people all along the canal path, and then all the homeowners in that whole section, they sent them a postcard ahead of time. So some people had parties, and it was a blast.
Yeah. That's awesome. Sounds like a great night.
Man, sounds like Colonial Belle. See, you see it go up and down the canal, but it has an effect all over, you know?
For sure.
It's so sweet.
For sure.
And I'm not going to lie, I was one of those annoying hecklers. Hey, blah, blah, you know, that are along the canal.
Oh, yeah.
I at one time was that guy. So,
oh, yeah.
Sorry.
They're everywhere. And a lot of people are realizing what my name is. So now there's all these people I don't know.
Oh, now it's even better.
Yeah, they're
now I'm just going to be like, I know her.
Next time we do an interview somewhere in Fairport, we're going to have to go and just be two idiots standing on the bridge.
Oh, man. That is so awesome.
It happens a lot. And it used to happen to my dad, and now it's my turn, I guess.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah, you definitely have that torch now that that you have to carry. That's awesome.
I love it.
That's great.
So what do people got to do right now to get tickets to for the summer, for the upcoming season?
Sure. So we have the option that we've always had since we started where people can simply call the office and book cruises. If you want to book online, all of the themed cruises have been up for sale since maybe January, February.
Got it.
So those ones are selling really fast. A few of them are almost sold out already, and we haven't even started our season. So that's wild. And then we have opened Sundays. We do a few different options on Sundays. Every other Sunday, we do a brunch cruise, and it's catered by Smokin' Hot Chicks.
Oh.
And then on the opposite Sundays, we do what we call the Family Special Cruise. And everyone rides for $15. It's an hour and a half short cruise. So people with young children or they don't want a long cruise, that's a great option. Everyone 3 and under is always free. And then we do that short cruise every other Sunday. And then we do an afternoon cruise, 2:30 to 5:30, which is a lot cruise. It's narrated, but there's also live music on that one.
That's awesome.
And then some of the other cruises, because to start with, we were booking private charters and groups of 25 or more. And enough of those groups of 25 or more have booked on certain dates where we've opened them up for public online booking too. So we'll keep opening more as we get closer to the season starting. But that whole PGA time and Mother's Day and all that stuff, it's all open again with all the themed cruises. Super and then the charters people call because those are all customized.
Yeah.
So what we would do with the charters, people would rent the boat for at least 2 hours. And then from there, we have a huge menu of different options that they can add food, drinks. They don't have to, but they have all those options available.
So cool.
Yeah. So and we're going to have all your information all week long in this show.
Great.
Yep. So people are going to be able to get a hold of you and hopefully sell out all the theme shows.
Yeah. We got to get our tickets before they sell out.
And that is true,
too. What are we going to do? We're going to have to look at the themed ones to see which one we want to do. Yeah. I'm definitely going to go to the murder mystery one, so you can plan on seeing me at one of those.
Those ones are interactive. So you get some of the narration, actually, on that one for some of the things along the way, and then the interactive stuff is happening while you're cruising, and then during the dinner portion, there's even more.
That's awesome.
Well, and knowing that you're the busiest person that I've ever met, we would definitely love to do another show with you during the season at some point from the boat, either before or after, or whenever you can pinch us in for another 45 minutes. We'd love to come down to the Colonial Belle and do an interview on the boat.
Yeah.
That'd be great.
That'd be cool.
That'd be awesome. Yeah. And then maybe we'll get some cool behind the scenes stuff.
Love it.
During a cruise. Maybe we'll do the interview before the morning before a cruise or something like that. And then we'll go on a cruise and hopefully be able to catch somebody dropping something from a bridge. That would be
really cool. You never know.
It'll be one of us.
Right. We'll have to put our sign, our banner on one of the bridges and take a picture of
that would be cool.
Yeah.
Yes.
It'd be awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And thank you for coming on the show. We appreciate it.
Yeah. Thanks for having
me. This was so much more than I expected it to be.
You just learned so much cooler. So much.
This is so much cooler than
I thought. And it's just great because it's here in Rochester. Mm-hmm. It is, it's a big deal here, and it's a great thing that you're doing, and I'm glad that you kept it going.
Yeah, yeah, me too. It's important. And I like that we're able to carry it on in a similar way that it's always been for our family.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's important. Rochester's amazing. We have so many things in this area for people to do and see. Yeah. And I'm proud to be part of that.
Yeah. Yeah. And so much of it is locally owned and operated, too, which we've always liked to put an emphasis on.
Mm-hmm.
Small business owner. Well, small. But, anything that's done locally. So, especially it's a family thing, too, that's right up our alley, so.
And we love that we get catering from local businesses. Mm-hmm. We get some of the drinks at the bar, local beers or wines or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, we're bringing in the amount of different businesses that we partner with is pretty cool.
And that's the thing, too, is I always told him, he was in the Rochester, in the restaurant business. And the Rochester community, when it comes to local businesses, they support each other. They want you to win, no matter what. Everybody sticks together, it seems, and it's just a great thing.
Yep. Yeah. We're members of Visit Rochester. We're members of Finger Lakes Tourism and some of those types of things. And the amount of networking and things that happen within those groups is just phenomenal.
Right.
That's awesome.
And then the Canal community itself, with Canal New York and with the Canal Society of New York State. Yeah. I'm on that board too. Just all those different things.
And that's just a whole nother world, the canal itself,
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is just a little, small section of what there is, up and down. Yeah.
The one thing Oliver and I like to do is we just, we have our regular show, but we also just like to promote local businesses of anything. And, to have you come on here is...
Yeah, super cool.
It was great.
Great, thank you.
Probably the most famous person we've ever had on.
I would.
For sure.
I would have to say.
Celebrity.
I would
Captain
have to
Tammy,
say.
You know what I mean?
Because
how many people know, the Colonial Belle? Way more than any other business that we've been at or interviewed. So maybe except for Three Heads.
Yeah.
I feel like Three Heads. Actually, no, technically, though, we've never had Three Heads on the show.
Right.
We only did that little interview at
Homegrown.
Thing, so our most famous guest. Nice.
Thanks.
I like it. That's awesome. But anyways, guys, for all of Captain Tammy and the Colonial Belle's information, please see the description down below. We'll also be promoting her all week long on all of our social media outlets. Yep. You can find us on Facebook and YouTube or anywhere that your favorite podcasts are played, including Spotify, iHeart, and Apple Radio. And don't forget, please, just hit that subscribe button, click on the bell notification, be the first ones notified when our new episodes hit.
Yeah.
And I didn't mess up during that either.
That was good.
That was awesome.
Got it all done.
And don't forget, what do we ask them to do?
All we ask is if you share with one person.
Just one.
Right?
For sure.
And
how hard could that be? And take a tour on the Colonial Belle.
Yes! Get your tickets now!
Yeah,
for sure. Love to have you aboard. We cruise from May 12th to October 29th this season.
There you go.
And, I didn't even mention it earlier because I looked it up. It's I thought this was going to be like a really expensive thing. It's really not that expensive.
Yeah, we have things like, all over the place.
Like two people for 2 hours is $48.
Yeah, it depends on the cruise. Depends if you're adding food or not.
Yeah, but we have still, all kinds of options. I mean, a basic option, that's $24 a person. It's $12 an hour per person. You can't do anything for $12. What can you do for $12 that takes an hour right now? Nothing.
Go on
you
the
can't
Colonial
even go to Shaler's and get a meal for $12 anymore. Like, it's crazy. And that takes 5 minutes to eat. Yep. So, anyways, if you want to go experience some of what Rochester has to offer, definitely check out the Colonial Belle.
Do it!
Yep. But anyways, guys, until next time.
See ya.
Cheers. That was awesome.